The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, Hunu Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
This show is based on true events. For legal purposes, we are not mental or medical or legal professionals, and we do not claim to be. If you observe or experiencing abuse, please seek help and report it. There is help. We may use video, audio, and other means to discuss the subject of true crime. For those of you who are sensitive, it's not your show, because we talk about graphic stuff and it's not pretty. So let's get started with the show. Well, it is Friday on Armed Radio and this is Betrayal. And I'm your host, Casey, for another true crime history mystery flippity floppity things. Okay, so tonight's show, and I'm still battling the cold. It is really terrible with all this weather, ups and downs and all arounds. Oh my goodness gracious, it's just not good for your sinuses, your allergies, and everything else. And it just seems like I'm just catching everything. Well, most everything. So not only am I taking like a bum load of vitamins and cough stuff, you know, I'm having to battle like congestion and coughing. So forgive me if I sound a little weird. So it's because I just am congested. Okay, so last week we discussed, or you heard about, the JFK assassination. And I thought it was important to listen to, because I mean, to be honest, you could go to any of the TV channels and see the reenactment of the actual crime itself. And you could see, you know, what the, you know, events were leading up to it, you know, shot from behind, he fell back, his brain splattered all over the place, he went to Parkland, blah, 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 blah. You can see that. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to get through the historical perspective of being on ground zero when all these things were happening around you that you didn't know about, to actually hear history as it was taking place in real time. Because a lot of people don't, you know, on those TV shows, they just kind of cut to it real quickly, or they just say, oh, he was given a speech, but they don't let you actually hear the speech or anything like that, because the most exciting thing and what gets viewers is looking at his head explode from his body and, you know, Jackie, you know, over the back end of the vehicle. That's the exciting part. And then looking at Jack Ruby shooting, you know, Oswald and everything. That's the exciting stuff. But, you know, you could talk about it over the, you know, podcast or anything, but it's not as exciting as looking at it through the millimeter film that everybody has, you know, remastered and everything like that. I mean, they've had historians out there like, you know, literally with the same make and model and people size-wise reenacting the whole event. I mean, it's just like a giant, I mean, in a way, tourist deal for November. Or, you know, when people come to Dallas, they're like, I have to go to the grassy knoll. I've got to see where he got shot. But you guys don't realize is that there's history in Fort Worth, which is like, you know, 30 minutes away from Dallas, that there's actual places where you can walk into that look like they're frozen in time. You can drive routes that a lot of people have forgotten about. So, you know, it's important to kind of hear those aspects of the story. And I wanted to play, you know what, because it is Black Friday. Holy crap, a load. Black freaking Friday. If you've ever watched the movie The Purge, which is disgusting, I hate that movie. And if you guys like it, that's awesome. But I think culture-wise, it is the message it has is disgusting. But if you want to watch something that's very similar to The Purge, go to Black Friday shopping. Go to the mall, go to Walmart when they have those lightning deals. You will see people crowbar a grandma to get a stupid TV for like 2 cents. Or you will see a grandma like elbow a kid to get like movies or whatnot. I mean, people go animalistic. They will totally, and it's just, it's like a breeding. It's like watching, it's like putting blood in the water and watching sharks like just attack it. It's just that animalistic. If you watch videos of it, I mean, last year they pushed a little kid over the rail, over the edge on the second level, pushed him over. He fell, and I'm telling you, by a miracle, he's walking right now. And, you know, just to get to deals. Malls are dangerous. There are people, I mean, I've heard on the news just alone, where they have scoped out people, followed them. When they hit a light, they basically block them in, open their car doors, and like literally like beating them up and grabbing the stuff. And then by the time the light changes, boom, it's like so quick. There's been like 5 of those instances in the Dallas-Fort Worth area where people have just gone batshit crazy like that over stuff. And I find it so ironic is like yesterday we were like, oh, I'm so thankful for what I have. And today is just like, I want it all. It's like we literally are like, you know, two different sides, two-faced basically. It's like one side we're like, I'm so thankful what I have. And then the next side is like, I want it. But yeah, I think I've only done one Black Friday. And I don't know if I even realized it was Black Friday. It was probably in the early days of Black Friday before it became super crazy. I would not. I would not do Black Friday at all. Online, that's one thing. Being in a store during Black Friday, oh heck no, it is not worth it to me. I'm sorry, I just and I've taken pictures of people like standing outside lines of the Best Buy or the Walmart or the Target. They're all camped out. They're like, yeah, we've been camped out since 2 a.m. I'm like, wow, that's some dedication there and everything. Even the cold weather, even in cold weather, they are, well, it's cold Texas weather, they're camped out. They got tents and they got chairs and they got stuff, places to go potty, porta potties. It is crazy just to get a deal. And then they're like, it's crazy. But I was coming across some audio files, and I thought that was really cool audio files. So sometimes whenever I find something that sounds interesting, I'm like, I've got to share this with the people. So this first one, I love Mr. Rogers. And if you guys are from a foreign country, you don't know who Mr. Rogers is. He's like the nicest guy who taught you that to like yourself for who you are, to be yourself. And unfortunately, he died like in 2006 of pancreatic cancer. And I think the world needs a lot more Mr. Rogers because he is such a cool guy. So I found a copy of the Mr. Rogers episode that dealt with JFK's assassination. Now, it is geared towards kids, but it is so interesting how he explains it. Mr. Rogers is awesome. He's kind of like the Bob Ross of things. If you know who Bob Ross is, he's the painter, if you're from a foreign country. Now, if you're from a foreign country, you don't understand the concept of Thanksgiving, and you probably don't understand the concept of Black Friday. Hopefully I explained it to you. But Thanksgiving is a day designated to where the Indians broke bread with the pilgrims. And it's basically a day of being thankful for what you have, thankful for your family, thankful for your food, and basically you gorge yourself on turkey and stuffing, and you watch football, and it's the Dallas Cowboys game, of course. Every year they do the Thanksgiving thing. American football, not European football, which we call soccer. And so you're just thankful that one day of the year. You're thankful, you do charitable acts for other people, hopefully, until, you know, it's kind of like the season of giving. So like between November to the end of December, it's like the season of giving, to where you give to, you know, charitable things that help other people out. Black Friday and Cyber Monday is where you basically eviscerate other people for stuff. I mean, people have gotten majorly hurt by the nonsense. But I'm going to play the Mr. Rogers thing. And then following that, this is about some really evil kids. And I thought it was really cool. So, you know, as you're walking through the mall or listening to this around the world, yeah. So I'm just going to be playing some, because obviously I sound horrible, I'm going to be playing some clips of different, crime events, just so that I can save my voice. I'm so congested. I sound horrible. But yeah, so I will come back and kind of explain some things, and let's get started with the audio. Okay. Excuse me. Correction. That file is just not loading, so that's not going to happen with the Mr. Rogers and the JFK episode. But basically, it was just stating that, you know, it's okay to feel sad and, you know, be scared, and appropriate ways, you know, to grieve and everything like that. So we're going to go to the forensic files, which happens to deal with a crime of two teenage, one a female, one a male. The female was both of them were decapitated, and their hands removed, her nipples were removed. You can kind of get more information, but it was considered a really evil act. Obviously it was an evil act, but it was happened around 1993, which 93, depending on when it was, either I was, if it was in the spring, I was a junior in high school. If it was in the fall, I was a senior in high school. So, I mean, it was like, right around that age, I probably, you know, those people are probably around my age and everything. So, yeah, pretty scary stuff. But let's listen to those forensic files.
On a sweltering Texas summer day in 1993, a work crew noticed something unusual off the side of the road. Under a thicket of thorned bushes was the nude, decapitated body of a young girl. Just 200 feet away was another body, a young white male. Residents of this small town wondered who would brutally kill two young people in this way, and what was the possible motive. Cut Off Road, a remote spot in Tellico, Texas, linked by a rickety wooden bridge over Smith Creek. This is the area where a road crew discovered the nude body of an adolescent girl. She had been shot, stabbed, decapitated, and her hands removed. She also had extensive wounds on her abdomen, thighs, and genital area. Under the bridge was another victim, a young white male fully clothed who had been shot twice in the head with a .22 caliber pistol. On a barbed wire fence, detectives found several long blonde hairs. In the boy's back pocket was a wallet with a library card.
The library card had the name, which stated James Brian King. And we thought that may be him, but we weren't sure at this point because it was not a photo ID type. It was just a card with a name on it.
The girl's identification was more difficult. Since there were no hands for fingerprints, and with the decapitation, no opportunity for a dental comparison.
She looked like a young, adolescent, teenage white girl. She also had amputations of both nipples and a number of other cuts, mostly on the front of her body. She had some very long cuts down the front of the abdomen with extrusion or evisceration of part of the intestines to the outside.
A rape test kit showed no signs of sexual assault. Homicide investigators visited the father of the boy, James King.
And we showed Mr. King the wallet that had been retrieved from the white male's body, and he opened it and looked at some of the photos and looked at the library card, and we could tell his eyes began to get watery. And he said, I recognize the wallet. You know, this is the wallet I gave to him, my son.
Mr. King also said that the girl's body might be his stepdaughter, 13-year-old Christina Benjamin, but wasn't sure because of the condition of the body. Mr. King told police that a few nights earlier, Brian was sleeping outside in a hammock when a car sounded its horn out front. He saw Brian talking to someone in a tan car. Then Brian got in and left. The next day, the family discovered that Christina was missing too. Investigators compared the hair on Christina's hairbrush to several long blonde hairs found near the murder scene on the barbed wire fence.
Once the hairs from the barbed wire and the hairs from the strand that were found out at the crime scene location were submitted to the laboratory, I produced microscope slides, and I compared those hairs to the hairs from the hairbrush, and they were microscopically consistent with one another.
The family also provided police with an X-ray of Christina's recent foot injury. That X-ray matched an X-ray of the girl's foot taken at the autopsy.
The night they found her, or the day they found her, Donna called me up that night and said, "Mom, I need some help." She said, "Chrissy, Dad, she's been murdered." And I couldn't believe it. And that's how we found out about it.
I could never imagine losing a child. And nobody, unless it's happened to you, nobody else can either. I can't imagine what my mom went through.
In the crime lab, Charles Lynch found a foreign blonde head hair on Brian King's pants, which did not belong to either Brian or Christina. Lynch also spotted a single fiber attached to Brian's sneaker. It was nearly invisible.
I looked at the fiber from the male victim's shoe using transmitted light microscopy. I'd seen those types of carpet fibers before, usually from Japanese vehicles, and this was a tan fiber, so that was my communication to the police, that it may be from a tan vehicle of Japanese make.
Investigators hoped that this single fiber would lead them to the automobile Brian King got into on his last night alive. The grisly murder of two local teenagers was a highly publicized case in the small Texas community where the bodies were found. The viciousness of the murders even shocked the pathologist in this case.
It's the worst case of mutilation that I've seen in my work here. I have seen other cases of mutilation and seen a lot of cases of what they'd call the crimes of passion or overkill, where someone's stabbed or shot multiple times. But this is the only case I've seen like this where someone had this much mutilation of the body, probably after death.
Psychological profilers say that killers like this usually have aberrant drives and appetites. The savage treatment of Christina was indicative of vengeance and extreme hatred and suggested that the killer knew the victim. Local prosecutors went to the FBI Behavioral Science Unit in Quantico, Virginia, to find out more about the mindset of this killer.
One of them said to me, after he looked at the photographs, he said, this is not a sexual crime. And I was a little confused because obviously she was nude and never found her clothing. And he said, whoever committed this crime did not have sex with her.
One trait common among individuals who have committed similar crimes is a history of abusing animals. Neighbors told police that Brian and Christina were planning to go out with a boy named Jason on the night they disappeared. And there was an anonymous telephone call to the sheriff's office.
The caller supposedly told this dispatcher that we needed to be looking at a subject by the name of Jason Massey.
Jason Massey was a 20-year-old high school dropout, the son of an alcoholic and drug user who spent his time moving from one run-down tenement to another. Jason was a petty criminal with a history of stalking, harassment, theft, and, most surprisingly, a history of abuse to animals.
A couple of days before the discovery of the bodies, Ennis police had received a call of a calf had been mutilated behind McDonald's. On their arrival, they observed a tan car. They also found a bracelet on the ground with the name Jason on it. There was a figurehead ran from the scene who was later identified as Jason Eric Massey.
Massey's friends painted a bizarre portrait of the troubled young man.
This guy also told me about how Jason Massey liked to mutilate animals such as dogs, cats, cows, and that Jason would, every chance he'd get, he would kill a dog and cut his head off. He calls them his trophies. And I said, well, what does he do with these heads? He said, well, he keeps them in a metal cooler.
And police discovered evidence that Massey knew Brian and Christina casually.
Jason Massey made comments about Christina, about how he really liked her and he wanted to take her out.
While everything seemed to point to Massey, there was very little forensic evidence found at the crime scene.
No smoking gun, so to speak. The case had to be developed. We had two children. The bodies were horrific, the way they were found, particularly the girl. Much work needed to be done to develop it.
The great difficulty in the case all along was what happened. How did this boy get killed? How did the girl get killed? What was the sequence? Was she sexually assaulted? What was the motive? Why was it done? And that was completely missing from the crime scene.
Police brought Jason Massey in for questioning.
I said, Jason, I want you to see something. And he looked at me and I threw down some photos of the crime scene, which showed Christina Benjamin and Brian King. And I said, Jason, I said, I want you to look at her. I said, tell me one thing. I said, is she as pretty now in these photos as she was that night that you had her? And he looked down and he looked at me, and the next thing I know, he's kind of bending over and he's gagging real, real big time, And I knew I had hit a a soft spot in him, you know, when he did that. I'll never forget that expression of him.
Despite the circumstantial evidence against Jason Massey, there was no proof. For that, investigators needed scientific evidence. Armed with a search warrant, police collected samples of Jason Massey's hair and also impounded his Subaru automobile. A piece of the tan carpet was removed for scientific analysis. Also inside were three stains on the seat, which tested positive for blood.
When we got into the trunk of Jason Massey's car, there was a single leaf with a blood stain on it, a roll of duct tape with apparent blood on it, and also a hammer that appeared to have blood on it.
There was no sign of the .22 caliber weapon used in the murders. However, police did find a cash register receipt for some .22 caliber ammunition, as well as a set of handcuffs and a hunting knife. Investigators received another phone tip, this one saying that Massey was seen washing his car inside and out at a local car wash. Police immediately searched the contents of the vacuum machine at that car wash inside. They found an appointment card from Massey's probation officer and a number of long blonde hairs.
Head hairs from the vehicle of Jason Massey and head hairs found at the car wash location were all microscopically similar to those of Christina Benjamin.
The blood found in Massey's car was tested for DNA, but it couldn't be compared to the bodies since they were too badly degraded for DNA analysis. Instead, scientists relied on reverse paternity genotyping. By analyzing the DNA profile of Brian and Christina's biological parents and comparing it to the DNA profile of the blood in Massey's car, scientists could see if there were similar genetic markers.
We were able to determine that yes, much more certainly that blood did come from Christina Benjamin.
Scientists also needed to know if the time of the deaths matched the time frame Jason Massey and his automobile were in the victim's neighborhood.
Our best evidence was a forensic entomologist that, looking at the larva activity found on the bodies, could come up with a pretty good idea of when they were killed in relation to each other and in relation to time in general.
Samples of the insect larvae from both bodies were sent to the prominent forensic entomologist, Dr. Neil Haskell. Haskell studied the larvae and attempted to cultivate live larvae from the same heat and humidity conditions that existed in Texas the week the bodies were found. By doing this, Dr. Haskell could approximate the time between when the flies laid their eggs on the bodies and the larvae developed to the stage in which they were found. Dr. Haskell determined that Christina and Brian died 2 days before their bodies were discovered. This coincided with the time frame that the tan automobile, similar to Massey's, was in front of Brian and Christina's home. Jason Massey was arrested and charged with capital murder. He pleaded not guilty.
Jason Massey was a handsome young man, and I was worried that if he took the stand and testified that he might sway some of the jurors.
Guilt or innocence would be determined by the forensic evidence.
No one of those sciences was able to show beyond reasonable doubt that Massey committed the crime, but put all together, it meant that either Massey had committed the crime or he had to be the most unlucky person in the history of the world, because every piece of evidence pointed toward him.
Before the trial ended, prosecutors learned even more about Jason Massey. Information that would seal his fate. In 1994, Jason Massey went on trial in Texas for the murders of 14-year-old Brian King and 13-year-old Christina Benjamin. Prosecutors believe that both Brian and Christina got into Jason Massey's car around midnight on July 27th for a ride in the country. Prosecutors also believe Massey's plans included much more than just a ride. Massey stopped his car on the cutoff road bridge and shot Brian King twice in the head at point-blank range with a .22 caliber pistol. He then pushed him out of the car off the side of the bridge. Christina got out of the car and ran. Jason followed, shot her in the back. But the wound wasn't fatal. Later, he shot her in the head, then stabbed her. Prosecutors believe the mutilation occurred after death. Christina's head and hands have never been recovered. The motive was difficult for prosecutors to identify.
There was no traditional motive in this case, and instead, Massey was most likely what's referred to as a lust murderer. That is, a person that receives a certain degree of sexual gratification from the killing and mutilation of human beings.
Before the trial was over, a hunter walking in the woods made a gruesome discovery. He found a red cooler. Inside were the decapitated heads of 31 animals and also the journals of Jason Massey revealing his hideous deeds and horrific thoughts. These Slayer books of death, as Massey called them, were a frightening and incriminating insight into the mind of a killer. A mind obsessed with murder, sex, and mutilation of young girls. The jury found Jason Eric Massey guilty of the two murders. Two young lives were avenged.
Mr. Massey, any comment on your guilty conviction?
No, ma'am, I'm just glad it's over.
For the penalty phase, prosecutors had just 24 hours to assemble the information contained in Jason Massey's journals to convince the court that the death penalty was appropriate.
He started out with killing 8 cows, 30 dogs, and 39 cats, and he cut off their heads and kept them as trophies.
Here's one where he's talking about a little girl, and he says that he loves her and he's decided to kill her. He just doesn't know when.
Prosecutors told the jury that Jason Massey's journal contained evidence that he had planned to kill again and again. Massey's writings revealed that his greatest aspiration in life was to become the most famous serial killer in America.
We wanted the jury to know just the kind of person that we were dealing with. And that person was one that was obviously going to be a predator of incredible proportions.
The jury deliberated just 15 minutes and decided upon the death penalty.
Well, the judge said, I sentence you to death by lethal injection, and the only injustice in this court today will be that your death will be so much more humane than that of your victims. The judge said that. And everybody stood up and cheered for the judge.
Jason Massey was executed on April 3rd, 2001. Christina's grandparents witnessed his last moments alive.
This was Jason Eric Massey's final statement just prior to his execution. He said, yes, first I would like to speak to the victim's family. First of all, I would like to say that I do not know that any of y'all, and that's unfortunate because I'd like to apologize to each and every one of you individually. I can't imagine what I've taken from y'all, but I do want to apologize.
I apologize to you for what I did. I want you to know that it was only I who committed the murders. No one else was involved. Christina felt no pain. The things done to her occurred after her death. I swear, the things done to her occurred after her death. I swear. Her head and hands I threw into the Trinity River. I didn't rape or torture her either. I admit my guilt, and I ask your forgiveness. I pray you will forgive me. If not now, then in the future. May God be with you and keep you through this. His servant, Jason Eric Massey. I don't know how to describe it other than we watched him die. We had no emotions other than we were watching this person die. He kept mouthing, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry." We didn't believe him. No, there's no way that you could forgive this man for what he did.
It was quick. It was painless. He was lucky. You know, the way I look at it, my brother and my stepsister weren't so lucky. I mean, you know, they died horrible deaths.
I'm not the one that was going to have to judge him. And I can't judge him, but I can never forgive him.
Detectives were very good and efficient. They did their jobs well.
Yikes, yikes, yikes. That is some twisted stuff. To think that the Trinity River is a pretty long river that he just tossed two heads, hands, and nipples into the river. And then he said that, oh, she was dead already when I did it, or they were dead when I was already did it, and she didn't feel anything. Well, I beg to differ, because if you shot her in the back and she was still running, she felt something. Until you shot her in the head, yes, it was probably brief at much, at least a minute or two, but yeah, she did feel something. Yeah. Terrible. I don't know what possesses a person to just be like, yeah, I think I'm going to go kill somebody today and chop off their heads and nipples and hands. Yeah, that sounds like a great idea. If that ever comes across your head or in your brain, perhaps a second thought would be in order. Perhaps take a second to kind of take a step back. Rethink things. Because generally speaking, when you commit a crime, granted, there have been exceptions to the rules, you get caught. They've gotten really good at finding people, no matter where they've gone. Now, unless you go to a country that they don't extradite from, that's one thing. But then, if you migrate out of that country, you have to be in that country. But I guarantee you, sometimes they think of ways to kind of extract someone out of that country and then get them back. But yeah, imagine being that same country, never being able to leave that country, because if you do, they're gonna pounce on you. Because I guarantee you, there's gonna be some eyes on you, watching your every move to see if you take a toe out of that country. Yeah, and of course, in current crime, there was a heist. And they stole jewelry from a museum and everything. They are looking for those people. I guarantee they're looking for those people. And that stuff is probably priceless, rare artifacts that, you know, if they see it on the black market or anything like that, they're going to know, oh yeah, you were the one who did it, or you are an emissary of someone who did it. So they'd have to like melt down that stuff or change it up to where, and then that's just ruining the artifact. But it's pretty crappy when you have to take something that other people are enjoying, you know, rob others of the benefit of seeing historical items because you're, you know, selfish on and wanting to get that stuff for yourself. And I understand, like, wanting to make a buck, wanting to make big money and everything, but there are many ways to do it in a different way, you know, than to steal priceless artifacts. Priceless artifacts, you know, those things can't be replaced. But people do it all the time. They, you know, they steal stuff. I mean, but just the intricacy and the thought process and the planning that went into the extraction, because these places are highly guarded. I mean, there are sensors and guards and security and everything like that to be able to just circumvent all that. And I mean, it's something out of a movie. It really is. It's in a way, it's kind of an awe-inspiring feat that they did. It's kind of like, wow, that's pretty dang cool that you did that. But the second time, it's like, dude, you just stole stuff that's like priceless and can never be replaced, and you're robbing other people the benefit of seeing history. So it's kind of a double-edged sword with that one. But yeah, crazy stuff. Now, this one, this next audio, I've stayed on the Queen Mary. I've stayed on the haunted floor of the Queen Mary. This is dealing with the haunted, this is a never before seen haunted tour of the Queen Mary. And I just thought it would be kind of interesting to kind of listen to that. And, yeah, kind of like a little bit of lighter stuff besides pure evil acts. So yeah, so I thought that'd be kind of fun to kind of see all that. But anyway, so it's, let me go ahead and get that queued up and played, and then we'll listen to that, and I think that will end our show for the most part. I'll just see how much time is left over. Okay, so another error. That audio is not loading. So I'm going to go and figure out what is going on with that on there. But, you know, trying to find some good, interesting stories to share on this Black Friday. So, you know, that you guys can actually hear that, because probably a lot of you guys are shopping, you'll hear this story later. Now, there is, you know what I can do is I can do, since we're talking about the Queen Mary, there is actually 15 celebrity suspects in famous unsolved mysteries that might be interesting to listen to. Now, granted, you know, if you guys don't quite care for that, you know, that's one thing. I keep getting bolos on here about potential hacking from like other sources and whatnot. And it's just, and all these Black Friday deals is like Black Friday deals. I'm like, nope, not gonna do it. But you might be fascinated by these, you know, stories from Hollywood. I'm very fascinated by, you know, different crimes that happened in Hollywood. And I'm going to tell you this, there's been a butt ton over the massive amount of time that Hollywood has been in existence of various crimes. One of the other things is that I was listening to something about the origin of the Lost Boys. That's that movie about the vampires with Kiefer Sutherland. It came out in the 80s. I think it came out in like 86, 87-ish. So yeah, it was about the vampires and it had, you know, all that kind of thing. But in Seattle, Washington, you guys, there's been an accounts. There have been numerous accounts, actually. When I was looking at the account of the man who walked across the mirror and he didn't have a reflection, well, there's been several accounts of young men who have black eyes, who basically are out during the night, and they were, this couple came to their car, got in the car, and one of the men, young boys who were on like this picnic bench in a park, they called this person's name. They knew who this person's name was. Well, they didn't know who they were. So how would they have known their names? So they basically had been drinking, and then they went and went to another bar. They came out of this bar, and the boys were across the street, and they basically called out to them, and they were like, hey, you know, what's up? And it kind of freaked them out. So they went to their car, they drove to, they had driven to, actually from a bar to like a movie. They watched a movie and then they came out and those kids were out there in a different location across town. How would they have known? So they get in their car, they drive home. And after he got inside his home, probably about maybe 15, 20 minutes later, he hears a knocking at the door. And it's like, they say his name through the door, let me in. Well, you have to be batshit crazy to let someone in. He's like, no, go away, that kind of stuff. I'm going to call the police. Knocks again, you know, let me in, I want to just use your phone. And then the next one was like, can I use your bathroom? He's like, no, I'm calling the police. And then the next one is, you know, let me in, I'm hungry. And at that time, a police siren went off. And then the knocking ceased. Well, there have been numerous accounts of missing persons who have never been, you know, found. And there have been numerous accounts of people who have black eyes who have been spotted, and then a person goes missing. There was a woman who was driving down a foresty road, and she sees a man on the side of the road hunched over. And I don't know what possessed this woman to pick this person up, but she did. She picks up this person and he averts his eyes. Clearly a sign that you should not have picked up that person again. And she just starts driving down the road. And it occurred to her she never asked the guy for his name or where he wanted to go. Well, at the time, they were passing by a tavern or something like that. And he said, you know, he said her name. And he said, you can let me off here. Well, she let him. When she was in the car, she was like starting to freak out. She's like, oh my gosh, I hope I'm safe. And he turns and he answers her. Is like, yes, you're safe. And then down the street, she's like, I realized I didn't ask for his name or where he wanted to go. And he's like, let me off here. And he said her name. And she didn't know who this person was. So it was almost like they could read her mind on both instances and everything. But there's also been instances in, I think, possibly in Texas that this has happened. That's so freaky. That's so freaky, you guys. That freaks me out a little bit. Because in the 90s, when you didn't have cell phones, I mean, I went to clubs. I walked streets. You know, I drove at night in various places down, you know, country roads. No cell phone, nothing like that. Never came across anything like that. But I did have an occurrence that happened to me in New Orleans. I was walking down a street in New Orleans by myself at night, in between Bourbon and whatever street that is called. And a guy came out. I looked at him, he looked at me, and for some reason I got this kind of weird ass vibe, and I was just like, I need to turn around. And I turned around and went back to a populated street. I did not go forward because something told me I should not be going forward. I turn around and I look and the person's gone. It was bizarre to say the least. But anyway, I digress on that one. So basically, it was freaky. There's some freaky stuff. I do think that there are, you know, paranormal stuff that's out there. Like ghosts and goblins and vampires and werewolves and, Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, you know, all that kind of stuff. There's stuff out there that we don't know about. Aliens. So, it's weird stuff out there, I can just say the least. But I thought, you know, just spending a couple minutes and just talking about celebrity famous unsolved mysteries. I mean, there's some freaky stuff in Hollywood. Hollywood? So some celebrities are just freaks. just to come up to it. They're just freaks. The freaks come out at night. And, yeah. So, I'm rambling on. It's probably because I'm congested and everything and all kinds of hyped up medicine. But, yeah. So, this episode is sponsored by Theraflu. If you ever get sick, take some Theraflu because that stuff is awesome. But anyway, here are the 15 celebrity suspects in famous unsolved mysteries. Now, these are still unsolved mysteries. And the great thing about it is if you want to feel like a detective, go check out some of those famous unsolved mysteries. Get the forensic files and kind of comb through it and see if you can't solve the mystery. You know? See if you can't solve, you know, what's her name? Natalie Wood's mystery. See if you can't solve some of these other ones. They're out there. Put your skills to the use on all that. And, you know, you could become famous for solving crimes and everything. There are people out there who have solved crimes that are like 50 years old and they give their family, their relatives peace. There are people who have solved other crimes and have gotten that person locked away. And that person might be in their 80s or in their 40s and they committed the crime in like their 20s. So you still could put bad people away if you solve these mysteries. The yogurt shop mystery in Austin, trust me, they want the help. And if you can solve that mystery on there and find that person and bring them to justice, or not even to bring them to justice, if you can help solve the mystery and they can go out and bring that person to justice, they will pay you good, you know, pay you in some G's there, you know. I think the reward for the yogurt shop crime, I think it's $10,000. $10,000 if you solve a crime. You know? And if you're in Austin, if you go to the police, they've actually got a mock-up of the shop and you can kind of look around on it. So, yeah. Solve the mystery. They would be grateful about that because having multiple brains with a task, it is multiple ideas, multiple perspectives. It's quite helpful to help bring justice and peace for those who are affected by this crime. So yeah. Go get you some. Well, once again, I'm clearly not going to give you any more audio files, not for this show. So probably next show, I'll do that. So I'm going to just ramble on because we do not have much more time left. So let's go back to the file that we actually did have, which was the Texas murders and the motivation behind it. This guy liked this girl, but ended up killing her. That doesn't make sense. That's not how you get the girl, you guys. You know, there's other means of it. And if he was in his 20s and she was a young adolescent, she was probably, you know, if she was under 18, I mean, if you're 20, I think you have to have the parents' permission to date anyone who's below 18. Otherwise, you're considered a pedophile. You can date if you are close to that person's age, like, you know, your girlfriend's 17 and you just turned 18, that's one thing. That's, you can do that. But if you're like 30 and your girlfriend's 16, that's not really acceptable. This is some stuff I've been told by the police and everything. Because when we were in high school, my brother was, his girlfriend was a sophomore and he was a senior. So that means he was, when they first started dating, he was, I think she was a freshman and he was a junior. So, I mean, that's not uncommon. I mean, when I was in high school, I knew a seventh grader who was going out with a junior in high school. And it was like, oh my gosh, you're dating a junior. How cool is that? And everything. And then I also knew eighth graders. I knew a ninth grader who was dating a senior. It was like, oh my God, you're dating a senior. How cool are you? You know, that kind of stuff. So it does happen and everything. But I knew of another person. He was a senior and this girl was my age. So she would have been a sophomore and they were dating each other. So obviously he would have turned 18 and she was like, you know, 15 going on 16 and everything. So clearly underage whenever he turned 18, but it was acceptable because, you know, they were close in age. And it's kind of like if you, is this some weird stuff that happens in Texas? Probably other places too, but, they're willing to kind of just not say, hey, you're a pedophile and everything, because technically she is a minor and you're an adult, you know. But it's kind of like if you have the parents' permission and they're cool with it, it's acceptable. Unless you're like too far up, like if a 25-year-old's dating like a 16-year-old, that's, you know, not acceptable. I would hope, but yeah, some weirdness that happens in Texas and everything. But it's happened. I knew tons of people who were sophomores with me who were dating seniors who, at the time, you don't think about, okay, when you turn 18, you're an adult and you're in the adult mind space. You're thinking like, cool, you know, I'm an adult. I get to do whatever I want. You're in that mind space. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe sophomores shouldn't be able to date seniors who turn 18. And maybe, you know, it is kind of weird because I turned 18 my senior year. I turned 18 in December of my senior year. So there was like 4 or 5 months where I was going to school and I wasn't the adult. But they still had me, you know, make sure I got my parents' permission to do something, even though I was 18 and I could technically authorize it myself. When you're in high school, they're kind of like, nope, you still need your parents' permission, you still can't do this. So they kind of still put you in that bubble, that high school bubble. But as soon as you graduate, it's kind of like, bye bye, you're on your own on that one. So yeah, so I think that's kind of interesting. So yeah, that's kind of the time frame. 1993, I was either a junior or a senior. First semester senior, second semester a junior. So yeah, it's just crazy. And I don't remember this story, but I don't think this story would have hit, out in West Texas. No, either I was in West Texas or I was in Dallas-Fort Worth, since Trinity River is pretty much, a pretty good size. It's probably towards Houston. So it probably hit the Houston news, and not anywhere else. Or if I just forgot it because I was kind of doing my own thing. So, alrighty. Well, I think I've babbled along enough for today. So, happy Friday. Be safe on Black Friday, you guys. And Cyber Monday. And I will see you next week, which will be December. The year's almost over, you guys. There's only a few more shows left. Bye-bye now.